Also, how about if we just celebrate for a moment last week? Last week was just amazing here as we gathered. We had two baptisms. We want to congratulate Deb and Travis on their baptism. That was awesome. Three people also welcome into the body of Christ when we invited people to come and join us into the body of Christ. And three people that don't normally come here raised their hand and said they wanted to make Jesus the Lord of their life. Now that takes a moment. We've got to thank God for that. We've got to thank God. That's the reason why we're here. That's the reason why we're here. So I'm excited about that. Now, the other thing that I'm excited about is you guys remember Manny and Wilma that came up here? You all remember Wilma, right? Stand back. Well, they're back here right now. They're sitting right there. Now, So when they were up here, they talked about how we need to make sure we reach the ends of the earth with the gospel, right? Anyone in on that program? I'm so in on that program, right? So Jesus said in Acts 1:8 that you're going to be my witnesses to the ends of the earth, right? Well, here we are in Leesburg. So not all of us are going to go to the ends of the earth, but we can partner with people who do so that we can extend the gospel to the ends of the earth too. Could you guys come up here a second, Manny? Make them feel welcome, please. Please. Awesome. So while they're coming up here, I want to remind you that they had mentioned that they needed some Bibles. And so when they got here, Manny, he cornered me in my office. He strong on me. And he said, no, you guys will get me 10 Bibles. No, he didn't. He asked if there's any way if we could have 10 Bibles to go back with them to Mexico so they can stop worshiping Guadalupe and worship Jesus. I think that's a good idea. So they needed some Bibles because they were over there and people are getting saved, but they want to learn. And so these two amazing, crazy Jesus freaks are going to go back over there and they're going to get with these people and they're going to teach them. They're going to disciple them. So we've got step one, right? We've made disciples. So they're believers now, but they don't really know everything that they need to know, right? So the next step is what? We baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We saw that last week. And then we're supposed to teach them all that we've been taught. And so they want to teach them all that they've been taught. And so we decided we would take up an offering to see if we could get some Bibles. So they needed 10. And these are the Bibles they needed. And you guys were so awesome that we got them 24. So we got a case of Bibles. So this is one, so there's 23 more in here, and I was, you know, I was thinking about this when the Bibles came in. I was like, do you remember when you were in high school, and you were hungry, and you didn't have any money, and you'd look at your buddy and you'd say, hey, you buy, I fly? Yeah. Okay, so that's the way it is here. We buy, you fly. Yeah, so that's what we're going to do. So here's one, and there's 23 more in here, and so they're going to think about this now. What you put in that basket is going to directly affect someone's eternity, right? That's insane awesomeness, right? And most of us aren't going to be able to go to Mexico, but they're going to go for us, and they're going to bring the good news of Jesus to these folks. Amen. So that's awesome. I want to take a moment. I want to pray for you guys. So if you guys would just take a moment and pray, let's pray right now. Let's just ask God to do some amazing work with them. If you don't mind if I put my hand on your wife, it's okay. So Father, we read in your word that it says that when the Holy Spirit falls upon you, you will receive power and you will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. And so Holy Spirit that resides in these two beautiful people, Lord, I pray that you would give them the power that you promised so they could bring the gospel to that community in Mexico with power and with clarity so these folks can know who you are, be saved, and become eternal Christians. Lord, not just that they would learn to know who you are, but Lord, that they would make disciples who would and then make more disciples, and that your kingdom would advance in unexpected, unexplainable ways in the city that they go to, Lord. Let it be an amazing, amazing season of ministry for these two. Lord, I pray that you will continue to provide all that they need as you have since they got on the road, if you will. You've been an amazing provider. And you said in your word that if we seek first your kingdom and your righteousness, all that we need would be given to us. And there's living proof right here. You have provided for their every need. And we pray that you will continue to do so. And thank you now that you will. In Jesus' good name, Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. Well, I don't want to let Dan and Tim be the only buffoons in here, so I'm going to do this. You ready? Merry Christmas, everybody. Merry Christmas. Thank you. It's kind of hot out to be Christmas, isn't it? It's so hot that I need to take this hat off. So, who was curious as to this whole Christmas thing? Raise your hand. Come on now. Couple people curious. Yeah, it's not Christmas, but Jessica was bored. That's the end of the story. So, we're studying the Gospel of Luke, right? And we're in Luke chapter 2, where Jesus is born. So it's Christmas, right? Doesn't have to be December to celebrate the coming of the Savior. So that's what we're doing. So hence all the Christmas decorations and the Christmas music and my stupid little hat. I appreciate the hat. So we're gonna study God's Word. It's my favorite thing in all the world is to study God's Word. I hope that it becomes your favorite thing in your whole life. And so at this time, I'd like to invite you to grab a copy of God's Word. They're everywhere. They're everywhere. Listen, don't take it lightly. God's Word is the greatest treasure you'll ever put in your hand. And so don't just listen to some dude because he's got a microphone on. You have a copy of God's Word there. All right? People have died to make sure you get a copy of God's Word. And here it is. So grab one of these Bibles that are in front of you out of the seat back. Or maybe there's one on the table in front of you. Or maybe you have one on your device, whatever. Maybe you have your own, and that's awesome. The Bible verses that are on the screen, when I get up here and I get going a little bit, you'll see some verses, and those will correspond with those Bibles that are here, these blue ones. And don't be fooled by the different covers. They're both the exact same Bible. These ones right here with the water on it, just newer, but they're the same thing. Now, I want to tell you this, that if you don't own a Bible, please feel free to steal one, okay? And I'm only saying steal one because then it adds to the fun of taking it home. If I tell you you can have it, that's not fun. When your parents tell you not to smoke, what did you do? Okay, I'm telling you right now, don't take one of these Bibles. I'm watching you, okay? Open up a copy of God's Word. We're studying in the Gospel of Luke. We're going to spend most of our time in chapter 2. You can find your way there, although we'll be in other places along the way, but that's going to be our main feast for the evening. We started out just recently. We're talking about Jesus building his church. He said, I'm going to build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail, right? And so we've seen evidence of that. Right here last week, we saw evidence of God building his church as hands went up to say yes to Jesus Christ, as bodies went down under the water to declare their death and rising to new life. God's kingdom is advancing. The king's glory is a growing population, and we're watching it happen right before our eyes. He's telling us in the scriptures how we're going to do it, though. Just can't come up with some little plan that you might have. Some of you are creative. Well, that doesn't mean much. He's got a way. And he said in the scriptures that when you lift up Jesus, he'll draw people to himself. Like, our job is to be the guy who puts on the tractor beam. Remember the sci-fi movies with the tractor beam? Like, you can't do anything about it. When you get in that tractor beam, it's sucking you in. And when we lift up Jesus, he's sucking people in, man. And so that's what we do. We lift him up. We worship him. We exalt him. We lower ourselves and we put him up high. That's what we're supposed to do when we gather as a church. And we're supposed to worship him, it says in John chapter 4, in spirit and in truth. And so we talked about that we have these emotions and feelings that God has given us inside of our being. And so when we come here, sometimes you get some people that are yelling. And sometimes people are clapping, and sometimes people are dancing, and sometimes people are crying. And these are emotions that God has put inside of you to be released to something or someone that's worthy of that. And we don't want to just release those God-given emotions and feelings, that spirited worship, to just any old thing, right? Are you with me? We want to base our worship on the truth, not some made up, conjured up, I think, I assume, perhaps I've been told that this is what God is. No, we don't want that. I want to know the truth. Amen? I want to know the truth. And so we're on a truth journey. And based on that truth, we can then release our spirits to this God, the real God. And last week, we spent some time talking about the fact that we shouldn't worship some things that some people worship. That part of genuine worship is to erase those things out of our lives that we're worshiping that aren't worthy of that. And we talked a bit about Mary, the mother of Joseph, the mother of Jesus. And that a lot of people exalt her way beyond that which God's word would exalt her. She was an awesome woman, but she's not to be worshipped. Amen? There's only one to be worshipped. And his name is Jesus Christ the Lord. That sounds so good. Listen, this is for me right now. I want you to do this for me. Would you guys do me a favor? This is my pay right here, right now. You ready? I'm going to say that again, and I want to hear you say it loud and proud. Jesus Christ the Lord. There is only one to be worshipped, and his name is Jesus Christ the Lord. That's all. I think he heard us. I think he's pleased. So we learned a lot about Mary, though, last week. She's an amazing woman. We learned in chapter 1, verse 30, it says this angel came to her. And spoke to her and said, you have found favor with God. And then Elizabeth, John the Baptizer's mom, she meets with Mary, and she says in chapter 1, verse 42, God has blessed you, Mary, above all women. And the fruit of your womb, your baby, your child, is blessed as well. That's amazing news. Her life has been altered severely. Here's this little, probably 13 to 16-year-old girl living in this little nothing town, nothing going on. And now, 2016, she's the most famous woman who's ever lived. She was a nobody. And God totally changed her world. Totally changed her world. So the question beckons when an angel shows up and says, you have found favor with God. And Elizabeth says, you're blessed above all other women. Like, what does that look like when you give up the reins of your life to Jesus? When you give up the reins of your life, you say, I'm a Christian now, and God, you take over. Like Mary, you probably have some expectations. But here's the problem. We're born with a sin nature. We're broken, right? We're not right. You're not right. You guys are so not right, especially Dan and Tim. They're so not right. We're broken people. So from broken people come wrong expectations. Nothing right can come out of something wrong. Do you understand? You can't expect oranges to grow on apple trees, can you? So you can't expect something right to come out of something that's wrong. And so we have expectations, many of us, probably much like Mary, about what it would be like to have favor with God, to be blessed by God. We must have some expectations what our life would look like. Well, I don't know about you guys, but I have to admit something. I like going online, and I like watching some things that are probably a little bit disturbing. You probably think less of me. I love watching, well, first of all, I love MMA stuff. I love cage fighting. Anyone else? Admit it. Okay. I like it when two guys just beat the tar out of each other. I don't even know why I like it, but it's fun. I like watching the raw, real street fights. Anyone? Come on now. Right? I don't even know why. It's a total sickness. I can sit there and I like watching hockey fights. Anyone like watching the greatest hockey fights? Those are the best. It's the only reason why you want to watch hockey. It's for the fights, right? I love that stuff. And I love, this is bad, but I love when stupid people do stupid things and it gets caught on film and they get hurt. Yeah. Right? You guys? I think that's so funny. Slap, I don't even know what that is, but okay. So I found one, right? Check this guy out. Like, talk about expectations, right? He's probably got some expectations of what's going to happen, right? But that's... Now, I don't know about you, but I'm sure that's not what he expected. He should have, because he's stupid, and he should have known that that's what's going to happen. But when he got up on the roof, he probably had some different expectations than what actually happened. I had some different expectations. Like, I'm super excited about this place right here. And I'm super excited about the fact that, and if you've been coming to church for a long time now, you're kind of super excited probably with me, because you can kind of see that the place is a little bit fuller than it used to be. So that's exciting, right? God is building his kingdom, right? This place was literally given to us. Like, we didn't have to raise a dollar to move into this joint. Like, that's insane, awesome grace. God has a plan, and he wants to do some crazy things, and we're almost done. Like, I don't know if you get a chance, if you've never been here before, by the way, the bathrooms are back here. Okay? But if you go back there, you're going to see that there's this whole new bathroom complex that we had to build, and like, it's almost done. It's almost done. Like, that's the last big thing. So once we paint it and put the toilets and set the fixtures, like, we're pretty much done, and we can be finished, and it'll be our best, and we can just start people. I can see them coming in, man. Can you see it? Can you see the people coming in? Can you see a room filled with hands held high to heaven, worshiping the living God? Like, I can see that. I can see that. I welcome you into seeing that, and that's what you're part of. That's what you're part of. But you know what? When I found out we were going to move in here, I went and I met with a general contractor. And I brought him the plans. I laid it out. And I said, here's what we want to do. What do you think? So he gave me a cost. And he said, man, you guys, this is nothing. I thought you were going to, that's a pretty big place, you know? And I was like, no, it's not really that big. It's actually the beginning. Amen. That was a good spot. That was a good spot for amen. Right? But he said, man, you guys, because he saw what we're going to do, he said, man, you guys can do that in less than a month. I'm like, I'm in on that program. It's been over 3 months now. Right? And we're not done. But we're close. We're close. But I had some expectations, right? We have expectations with our churches. Oh, my Lord. We have expectations with our job. We have expectation with our family. We have expectation with our friends. We have, here's a, you ready to go? Oh, an expectation of our government. Oh, my goodness. Expectations for the election. Oh, it's the best this country could come up with. Okay, totally off track. But anyway, we have expectations. And so it's not always what we think they're going to be. So when we become a Christian, sometimes we have expectations of what being a Christian is going to look like. And I don't know about you, but sometimes my life and my expectations couldn't be further from each other. Anybody else with me, or am I the only one who's completely wrecked? I see one hand, two hands, three hands. Come on now. Honesty, right? Because we've met some Christians, and they told us what God did in their life. I'm so blessed. Boom, right? I'm so blessed. And they're driving around in their Mercedes. Bam, right? You just want to knock them out with some Christian love. So we have these expectations. And they're, you know, I'm not ripping Joel Osteen. Great guy. I'm sure he's a wonderful guy. But he is so stinking smiley. I can't smile like that. I'm missing a tooth. What am I going to do? I could only preach in Lake County. I couldn't get a job anywhere else. This is the only place I could do this. Now, don't go looking at that hole in my face for the rest of the night. You pay attention to God's word. I got problems. So we got some expectations of our Christianity based on what we might have heard on Google, or what other people have told us, how God worked in their life. And so what we do is we levy that expectation onto our own relationship with God, expecting it's going to be just like everybody else's. It's going to be good and great and this and that. And it's not always that way. So we see here in the text, we're looking here at Mary, right? And what happens is you'll see that there's a census being taken in the Roman Empire, and so people have to now go to their ancestral city to be counted. You know, you don't just get something in the mail like we have now. We make it easy. You got to go to the right place, and so she has to go with Joseph on a 75-mile trip from Nazareth to Bethlehem. Now listen, 75 miles when you have a nice car with new Goodyears on it and AC, it's no big deal. When my wife and I go riding on our motorcycle, a normal ride out on date night is 75 miles. It's no big deal. Okay. Now, how many people, show of hands, how many people would enjoy a trek through the desert for 75 miles on foot? How many people would like that? I mean, the average person, if you're in really, well, let's just say if you're in really good shape, like, you know, like working out and exercising, maybe you could go 20 miles in a day. Would that be reasonable? If you walked 20 miles in a day. So here we are, 75 miles, and no one raised their hand. Now, let me ask you this. How many moms are out there? Raise your hand. How many people have had some kids, right? Okay, now, how many people would like to make that walk through the desert 7 or 8 months pregnant? When you can't breathe, you just got done with a season of barfing all over the place, and now you're so big, and it's up into your lungs, and you can't breathe, you can't sit down, you can't stand up, the left hurts, the right hurts, everything hurts, you hate everybody, get this demon out of me, and so now you got to go across the desert 75 miles. Oh, highly favored, right? Okay, right? So now let me ask you this. How many people would like to do that as a pregnant woman who's 7 or 8 months pregnant over the desert riding on like a donkey? Ba-boom, 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 ba-boom. Like 7, 8 months pregnant for 75 miles. Like that's not favorable, is it? So, but Lord, I found favor with the Lord. I'm blessed above all women. How about this? I finally get there. I'm going to birth the Messiah, the long-awaited Messiah. I'm going to be the most blessed woman in the world, the most famous, and my kid's going to be the Lord. He's going to be the Messiah, the Savior, and I'm favored, and I'm blessed above all women, except that when I get to the town, I have to sleep in a barn. I have to sleep, and listen, I don't even know what was in that barn. She may have slept on hay. Can't promise it was clean. Anyone ever muck out any stalls in their day? She could have been laying in that too. I don't know. She could have been in the slops where the pigs are. I don't know what was going on in that little barn. But here she is, favored and blessed above all women. And the child that you carry is blessed. But except I have to deliver this child in a barn and lay this kid in a food tray that animals are eating out of? How does that work in Mary's mind? Talk about expectations, right? So the angel comes and says, "This is your favorite and blessed." And so she probably had some expectations. It's not, doesn't seem to be working out. Do you know my daughter, Chelsea, she just had her second child recently, you know, little baby Ezra. Cute little baby. And I love that little baby. It's a cute little baby. But I tell you one thing that Ezra is not. He is not Jesus. But while Mary is in a barn delivering God on a pile of hay, Chelsea, my daughter, who I love, great lady, great girl, love her, right? Her and her husband, boy, I don't even want, who knows what the heck's going on. Pray for her. But good guy. And they're, you know what they had? They had Waterman Hospital, right? They're at Waterman Hospital. They had a baby Ezra. It wasn't baby Jesus. And they had a steak dinner. They get a T-bone steak dinner for two. She's got her own private room with a bed that you push the button, it goes up and down. Cable with every channel. Sparkling cider, so it's kind of like champagne for them. And she's having baby Ezra. I love my little grandson, but come on. It's not Jesus Christ the Lord. She's not favored above all women on earth. And she's got a steak dinner in a private suite with cable and air conditioning and a bed that goes up and down, and she's having steak dinner. And Mary is in a barn. That's crazy. She's favored by God. She is blessed above all others. There's a famous Bible verse. If you've ever been to church and you've ever known anything about Christianity, you probably know this one. It's a coffee cup verse. It's on t-shirts. It's on bumper stickers, all that stuff. It's Romans 8:28. Anyone ever hear of that one? Romans 8:28 basically says this, and we know that God causes everything to work together for the good to those that love God and are called according to his purpose for them. So we read that and we're like, you know what? I'm a Christian. God's going to work it all out. It's all going to be good. It's all going to be good, right? We read that. But then we look at our life, like Mary. I'm favored above everyone. I found the favor of God. I'm blessed above all women, but my life is just a train wreck. And I read this, I'm like, yeah, God's going to work all things out for the good to those who love him. But we pay attention to that, but we don't pay attention to the stuff that's been underlined. So the stuff that's been underlined is the key to the verse. Yeah, things are going to work out for you. If you love him, sure. But the second part is the most important, and that is, and are called according to his purpose for them. Okay, for his purpose for you. Not your purpose for him, his purpose for you. And so when you talk about all things working out for the good, you got to start thinking about Romans 12:2 that says, don't copy the behaviors and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way that you think. See, we need a change in perspective. If Romans 8:28 is going to apply to your life, you have to have a change in the way you think. And here's the change that you need. You need to take what we like should be what brings God glory. The only thing that you should like is not what pleases you. It's what pleases God. And even if it doesn't feel good, even if it doesn't look good, even if it doesn't sound good, if it brings glory to God, listen, you must like it. That's when all things are working out for you. When you're doing stuff that brings glory to God. But in some cases, much like Mary here, having the favor of God kind of feels like a curse, right? She was told that she has the favor of God. She was blessed above all women. And here she is having to go on this trek, 8-9 months pregnant, through the desert, bump-a-dump-a-dump, on a donkey, uncomfortable, not pleasant, having to give birth to this Messiah, this Lord in a barn. Favor of God? See, when you got saved, you probably understand that God's grace was upon you, that he gave you a gift, and you're blessed, and you're part of the family. And so Mary was probably feeling that way too, but things weren't really working out. Like if she could write her ticket, her expectations weren't, I bet you they weren't. You know what would be awesome, Lord, is if I could get extremely uncomfortable where I couldn't breathe, and then get on a donkey and go through the desert for 75 miles. Like, that would be the best. Please, in Jesus' name, make that happen. Like, that's not going to happen. She didn't say, well, you know what I'd really like to do is I'd really like to give birth in a barn that was really uncomfortable, and there's no doctor, and I don't know what's going to happen. I'm sleeping with the pigs, and I'm sleeping on poop, and I'm sleeping on hay. Like, that is not the ideal. Certainly, these are not things that pleases her flesh. And so she had some expectations that probably didn't get met. So it's kind of an up and down journey for her. But then what happens is you see in the scriptures, you see that these shepherds show up. And so she's given birth in the barn, and that's not really that awesome, right? She's given birth in the barn, and all of a sudden, these shepherds show up. You see it there in chapter 2 of the Gospel of Luke. And it says that there were shepherds and, you know, they were there tending their flocks. They were doing their shepherd thing. And an angel of the Lord shows up. And this angel of the Lord keeps popping up. And so things are happening. And he shows up and they're terrified. And this big, mighty angel is like, don't be afraid. And I'm like, yeah, sure. I bring you good news. The Savior, the Messiah, the Lord has been born today in Bethlehem. So they've been waiting for hundreds of years, nearly 1,000 years have been waiting for this Messiah to come. And finally, the angel shows up and said, finally, the Messiah is here. So they're all excited. And so what happens is they take off running and they go and they try to find Jesus and they find him in the barn. And the shepherds show up and they see Mary and they see Joseph and they see the baby wrapped in the cloth and he's laying in the manger and they know this is him. And so it says that they start telling everybody. It says in verse 17, it says, after seeing the baby, Jesus. The shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. So they show up, and even though she was favored and blessed, and oh yeah, oh, this is going to be awesome, right? But then it goes downhill, and she's got to go through this trek through the desert, and she's got to give birth in a barn. Like, things aren't going well. But the shepherds show up, and they give her a confirmation. Like, yeah, man, your kid. I know things aren't great, but your kid is going to be the Messiah. It's going to be the Savior. He's the Lord. Your kid is the Lord. Right? So she's confirmed that everything's going real well. So she's back up on high. You're starting to see your life in this? Up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, right? And 8 days later, she's confirmed, right? She's excited. I have the Lord. And 8 days later, they go to the temple because they're going to dedicate their child, Jesus, to the Lord. And the Bible tells in Leviticus, I think it's chapter 12, that when you bring your child to the temple to dedicate them to the Lord, you're supposed to bring an offering. Let me just say something. You never go before the king without an offering, okay? Don't go before the king without an offering. It might be an offering of praise. It might be an offering of lowering yourself. I don't know what it is, but don't go to the king without an offering. And so they go to the king to bring an offering, and they're so broke that the normal offering that the law requires, which is a lamb, they can't even afford it. So they have to give the concession offering, which is two pigeons. That just even sounds lame. That's what they had to give. So here's Mary and Joseph. Mary's been told by this angel that she's favored and she's blessed among all women, and the child is blessed. Everything's great. He's the Messiah. His reign will last forever. And then right downhill, desert trek, born in a barn, and broke. Talk about unmet expectations. I've given myself over to you, Lord. I want what you want, Lord. Your will, not mine, Lord. But really? A barn? And I'm so broke I can't even give you my offering. Mary is much like she was in the first chapter, confused and disturbed. And I don't know about you, but if you came to Christ, you had some expectations, and maybe you look at your life, and maybe your life isn't exactly what you thought it would be in Christ. And so Mary is, once again, confused and disturbed. You see there back in the text, and I read verse 17, after seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. Verse 18, all who heard the shepherd's story were astonished, but Mary kept all these things in her heart and thought about them often. And she's confused, man. Like, what does all this mean? I don't know what to do. I don't know how to handle this thing. You know, you got a good season, you got a bad season, you got some good stuff going on in your life. And then you get a rough patch where it's kind of bad stuff, or so you think. It kind of sounds like my life. And as a matter of fact, I bet you it sounds very much like whose life? Yours. Probably everyone in this room. It's going well, it's going bad. You get good stuff coming into your life, you get some yucky stuff going on in your life. But we're just looking for some momentum, right? A little traction in the good stuff. Did you ever ask, I don't know about you guys, a confession time, right? Did you ever just be like complaining to God and just say, dude, would you throw me a bone? Come on. Anybody? Man, I do that all the time. Because I get confused. Like, I think it should be different than what it is. You know, I read the Bible. I see the great things that you did, Lord. Why isn't that happening in my life? Well, maybe because you're not Joshua, fool. Right? Why doesn't that happen? Why can't I look at the sun and say, sun, stand still? Maybe you're not Joshua. Why aren't the Red Sea open? Why is not the Red Sea open? I got a problem. I don't see a way. Moses did it. Well, you're not the Moses. You're a different one. Maybe that's why. Because I have expectations. And God, you better meet them. Throw me a bone. Throw me a bone, Lord. Let me just tell you something. The bone that God usually throws us is being used for his purposes. That's the bone. That's the bone. If you do as God directs, if you do exactly as God directs, whatever the result is, it is good. Do you understand? He is good. He's the only thing that's good. Do you know that? Do you know that none of you are good? That's church growth right there, right? That'll grow it. None of you are good. No, you're not. I am. Terrible. But the Bible says that only God is good. So listen, if you do exactly what he says, no matter what the result is, by definition, it is good. Whether you like it or not, whether it feels good or not, if you do as God says, the result is good. Do you understand? So he says he's going to work all things out for the good to those who love the Lord or call to his purpose. You do what he said, that good is what pleases him, not you. Now the challenge is getting on his track, because we're not always there, right? Because we do what he says, and then we get this result. It wasn't what we wanted, and we get ticked. Throw me a bone, Lord. He's like, dude, I so threw you a bone, and you didn't take it. The word for purpose in Hebrew, like when you get the Jewish folks back in the day, when they're talking about God's purpose, it's this word. I'm Jewish, but I didn't pay attention in Hebrew school, so I had to write it down the funky way, and it's kahefetz. It's the Hebrew word that says, it means God's desire. It's his desire. It's his pleasure. It's his purpose. It's his will. So all things are going to work out for the good to those who love the Lord and are called according to his desire, what he wants done, what he wants to see accomplished. And so that's the retrain that God wants. When the Bible says in Romans 12:2 to let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think, this is what he wants to try to change the way you think right here. If this thing, whatever it is in your life, whatever your circumstance, whoever that person is that's driving you absolutely freaking crazy, whatever the situation, the circumstance, whatever you're in, whatever your thing is, right? See this? That's your thing. Whatever this thing is, if this thing brings glory to God, then say this, I like it. I like it. Even if it hurts. Yeah, even if it doesn't feel good. If I do as God directs, the result is good and I like it. Man, can you imagine if you could get to that place emotionally, mentally, spiritually, that when you obeyed God, no matter what happened, you were singing like Candy was, it is well with my soul. That would be awesome. Nothing could get to you. Can you imagine if you had that armor on, that nothing this world could dish out to you would ever affect you? And you were positive and uplifting and encouraging, happy and smiling all the time, no matter what happened. Praise God, that would be insane. Who sees that? Never. 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 But that's what he wants. That's what he wants. Now listen, I just lost it right there, but that's not me all the time. I want to get there. He's preaching to me right now, right? That's God talking to me. I need to readjust my thinking. I need to readjust my thinking. Listen, often your circumstances, what's going on in your world, and God's glory are distant shores, aren't they? It seems like it, that they're way far apart. Nowhere near each other. Or so it would seem. See, that's the way it looks in our mind, in our natural eyes, in our still remaining human thinking that needs to be purged. Amen? We think that God's glory and my circumstance are way far apart. Oh, no. Do me a favor and go to Romans chapter 11, verse 36. I just want you to see this so that you can be refreshed in your spirit, especially if you've got something. If you've got a thing, anyone got a thing? Who's got a thing, right? All of us have a thing, a little thorn, a little problem, a little annoyance, a little expectation that's not being met, a little circumstance, little something, something, right? Something's going on, and it's driving you crazy. And you thought it would be, you know, it wouldn't be this way, Lord.
Throw me a bone.
11:36. You there? Are y'all there? I'm going to give you time. Romans 11:36. Right there. We'll give you time to get there, man, because I want you to see God's word, because it has the power to save you. Y'all ready? So what does it say? It says, for everything. Can you do me a favor? What's the word I just said?
Everything.
What does that exclude?
Nothing.
Everything. Every single thing. Everything comes from Him. Who's Him? Yeah. That's always a good answer in church. Amen. For everything comes from Him and exists by His power and is intended for His glory. All glory to Him forever. So you might think to yourself for a moment, this thing is not good. It's bothering me. It's not pleasing to me. This is not what I thought it would be when I bent my knee to Jesus Christ. And so we get grumbly and complaining. I'm the worst at it. Open confession in church. But what does it say? So take your thing and put it in right here. Put your thing in this situation. Everything, so you got a thing, you just got included. Everything comes from Him. So if you got a situation in your life that you don't like and you're not pleased with, it's not what you want, you had an expectation. Listen, it doesn't make a difference. Guess why it's there? Because God brought it there. And so the challenge is we need to readjust our thinking. And when we read the Word of God, it says, hey, everything comes from Him. So if this is from Him, I did what He said, and I got this situation in Him, glory to God. Imagine if you could do that. Can you imagine, listen up, everyone, can you imagine if you could pull that off? That no matter what happened, you could go, glory to God. One of the reasons why I love Greg is because every single time I meet him, and he just got through cancer treatment, loud and proud, Greg, I didn't prep you for this, and you're a quiet guy, but every single time I say, Greg, how are you doing? What do you say? Every single time. What if things are crappy and you get cancer? What did you say in the hospital bed when I visited you? Truly blessed and highly favored. That's awesome. That's where we all need to be. That's where we need to be. We need to retrain our minds. That's what God's trying to do here with His Word. So that's why you're here tonight, to retrain your brain. We have to understand that every single thing comes from God. He sent it into your life, and it exists by His power, so it's there because of Him, and it's going to stay there because of Him until you retrain your brain. You want to get out from underneath that situation? Change your attitude about it, and you'll be released from it. And then it'll bring you into another season, and it's going to be rough. But when you realize that everything comes from Him, and it's intended for His glory, the situation has a different perspective, doesn't it? A little different attitude about it. It's kind of different. Everything comes from Him, and everything is intended for His glory. Even a 75-mile trip on a donkey through the desert, sleeping in the barn, even if I'm broke, God knows He's there. He sent the situation into your life. Even all that stuff that Mary was going through. Yes, even that. And so when you plug your thing into this equation, much like Mary, right, you can't see it. She couldn't see beyond her situation. She didn't understand that all things were brought into her life to bring Him glory. And so she may have been frowning about it because it wasn't going the way she thought. And certainly all these situations that she was in, she's probably not thinking, man, I get to deliver this baby in a barn. I'm favored among all people. I found the favor of God. I get to give birth to my baby in a pile of hay, in a barn, with animals and poop and stink, right? Yes, and even in that, intended for God's glory. Yes, even her son one day falsely accused and being whipped and beaten and put up on a cross to be killed and put into a grave. Yeah, even that was for God's glory. Imagine a mother's grief for a moment. The same woman who was told, "You are favored among all. You found the favor of God, and you are blessed above all women, and the child you carry is blessed." Now those words, if the angel of the Lord came to you, would those words ring in your mind probably for the rest of your life? If the angel of the Lord appeared before you, right? So with these words ringing in her mind, just 30-some years later, she's watching that child who was promised by God to have been blessed above all kids, that child, imagine the mother's grief, watching that child be falsely accused, spit on, stripped down naked in front of everybody, and tortured and killed. You think she's believing in the favor of God in that moment? Do you think maybe she's thinking, "Man, I don't understand this, man. He told me I was blessed. He told me my kid was blessed. He said I found favor among from God. And look at this." Does this look blessed to you? I wouldn't think so. So we go on in our text here in Luke, and back in chapter 2, we're introduced to this guy, Simeon. He's a priest. He's waiting for the Messiah to come. I'm not going to really spend a little of time with Simeon, but you can read it, and I hope you are. But Simeon meets them there in the temple when they bring Jesus. The long-awaited Messiah is here. He's got the Holy Spirit all up over him, and the Spirit leads him to the temple that day. And Mary and Joseph come, and they present the baby to the Lord, and Simeon just praising God because he's there. And verse 29, I'm going to just start reading there. So here's this Simeon guy, and he's waiting for the Messiah, much like all of Israel's been waiting for almost 1,000 years. And he says, "Sovereign Lord, now let your servant die in peace, as you have promised. I have seen your salvation, which you have prepared for all people." Now remember, Mary and Joseph are sitting here listening to this. So they've heard what the angel has said to them personally. They've heard what the angel said to the shepherd personally. And now they're hearing this guy, this priest of God, say these things. "I have seen your salvation, which you have prepared for all people. He is a light to reveal God to the nations." I mean, just think of the thinking here. To the world. "And he is the glory of your people Israel." So once again, you see the roller coaster ride of Mary and Joseph? They're told one thing and it goes downhill. They're told another, it goes downhill. Here they are, encouraged again. And so it says, verse 33, "Jesus' parents were amazed at what was being said about him." Like I can understand Mary's attitude of disturbed and confused, and we're probably like that too when things don't go the way we think. Unmet expectations, right? What does it say? Let's just read on. "Then Simeon blessed them, and he said to Mary, the baby's mother." Now remember something. He's just said, "He is the light to reveal God to the nations. He is the glory," there's that word glory again, "of your people Israel." Okay, we got that. They just heard that. And right away, he says, "This child is destined to cause many in Israel to fall." Now, didn't he just say he's going to be the glory of your people Israel? But yet in the very next sentence, he says he's going to cause the people in Israel to fall. Confused and disturbed. This poor chick has no idea what's going on. And we're like that too. And then he says, but he will also be a joy to many others. He has been sent as a sign from God, but many will oppose him. As a result, the deepest thoughts of many hearts will be revealed. Now that's cool. We stop there, right? That's cool. So we're totally confused. He's supposed to be the glory of Israel, and then he's going to make people in Israel to fall, but some people are going to like him. And so she's like all over the place and thinking, like, what is this supposed to look like to literally give my life to God and to trust him? And some of you probably feel that way still to this day. But here comes the crushing blow. Up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. What is this supposed to be? "And a sword will pierce your very soul." The heartbreak on the horizon of Mary's life is beyond anything she could ever imagine. She can't imagine what she's about to face with her son. Who could, right? We know the story, but when you watched The Passion of the Christ, were you not floored? It crushed you. And you knew exactly what was going to happen. This lady has no idea what's about to happen. And this guy prophesied that this, your heart is going to be tore out because of your son. She has no clue as to the glory that God will receive through her son's life, death, and resurrection. The Bible says in Isaiah 53 that it was the Lord's good plan to crush him, Jesus, for our sins. God's good plan to crush Jesus. What happened on the cross was exactly what God had intended. That was his good plan. Do you see how you need to retrain your thinking? Who would think that that's the good plan to put your kid up there? I wouldn't. And I love Jesus. But I wouldn't think that's a good plan. But it was God's good plan. And so good for God has to mean good for me, no matter how I feel about it. That's what we need to retrain our mind about. It needs to be reprogrammed to be thinking that way. If it's good to God, then it's good to me. It's a change in thinking. And listen, loved ones, we've been blessed so much, all of us right here, beyond even what Mary was blessed, because we've been given God's word. We've been given God's word. And in God's word, we have the opportunity to have clear hindsight. Did you ever hear that expression? Hindsight's 20/20. You can look, when you're past an issue, you can look back on it and go, oh, I get it. So with God's word in front of us, we can actually look and have this distinct advantage of seeing that which seemed bad actually bring glory to God in amazing quantity. That's what the Bible is for. Do you get it? And that's why we're to read it. That's why we're to study it. That's why we're to meditate on it every day and every night. So when the trials of our life come in, much like it was for Mary, we can sing, "It is well with my soul." So we talked a lot about Mary. I'd like to talk a little bit about Joseph, right? What's up with Joseph? What's the deal with Joseph anyway? Joseph kind of gets a bum rap. The Catholic Church, they love Mary, right? Mary is exalted above all. She is famous. Even if you're not a Catholic, you know who Mary is. Everyone knows Mary. She's famous, man. That's Jesus' mom. But what about Joseph? He gets so dissed, man. Nobody ever talks about Joseph. So I want to talk a little bit about Joseph because there's some good teaching in the life of Joseph. There's some meat there for you to chew on that'll help you. Nobody really talks about Joseph at all. You know, with Mary, it says that the Holy Spirit is going to impregnate you and you're going to give birth to the Lord. Like, you're going to do this. It wasn't like, hey, do you think you'd like to give birth to the Lord? He didn't ask any questions, did he? He said, the Holy Spirit's going to come on you. You're going to conceive a child and he's going to be the Messiah and his reign will be forever on the throne of David. That's what it was. And she believed him. That's awesome. But Joseph's a whole different story. See, when Mary was told what was going to happen, but Joseph, well, he's just got some choices to make. He's got some choices to make. So, see, an angel appeared to him and said, hey, this is what's going to happen over there with Mary. Now you got some choices to make. And we have choices to make here, all of us, right? So last week and some of this, we spent some time examining Jesus' mom, Mary, not to be worshipped, right? But as an amazing example of faith for us to follow. But what about Joseph, the stepdad? Any other stepdads in here? I'm a stepdad. Yeah. Real easy, right? You're not my dad. Oh, man, I'll knock you for a stinking loop. Right? I can't even go on. I want to hit someone right now. If Bailey was, and I'm just kidding, I would give her a big hug. Stepdads, sometimes they get the diss. Stepmoms do too. You know that Luke, who's doing all this research about what happened with Jesus, he hardly even mentions Luke. In Luke chapter 2, we see that when the census is coming, it says that Joseph took his wife, or not his wife, his pregnant virgin fiance to Bethlehem for the census. And he's mentioned by name. After that, he's only mentioned one more time in the whole gospel by name. Every other time, he's just grouped into the, and Jesus' parents did this, and Jesus' parents did that. He's not even mentioned by name. We know all through the rest of the New Testament, Mary's mentioned tons of times. Mary, 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 Mary. But Joseph, he's not even hardly mentioned. So to learn about Joseph, you have to look in the Gospel of Matthew, and I welcome you to turn there to Matthew chapter 1, verse 18 through 25. I'm just going to read this to you. If you want to turn there and read it along with me, you can. We're just learning some truth, right? This is how Jesus the Messiah was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph, but before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her fiancé, was a good man, and he didn't want to disgrace her publicly, so he decided to break the engagement off quietly. The betrothal, right? Prearranged marriage. Mom and dad said this will work for you guys, whether you like it or not. And he's going to break it off. As he considered this, considering this sort of a divorce, if you will, an angel of the Lord appears to him in a dream. Joseph, son of David. Okay, first of all, he's not the son of David, right? His daddy's name was not David, but he's in the line of David, which is where the Messiah is to come from. So that's an awesome task to be given. Do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit, and she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet, which said, "Look, the virgin will conceive a child, she will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. So we see some things here in this story in Matthew, two things that you can observe. One is that it says that Joseph was a good man. But it also shows that he was a faithful, obedient man, right? That he did what God told him to do. So that doesn't necessarily mean because he was good that he was a faithful, obedient follower of God. Or it wouldn't be mentioning them both. So good must mean something else. Maybe he was a moral guy. Maybe he had some integrity and some character. So when you see what the story says, I would just say in our vernacular now, I'd say he's a stand-up dude, right? He's just a stand-up dude. He was just doing the right thing, right? He was just doing good. But he was also an obedient man of faith. Why? Because God said to keep her as a wife. So what did he do? He kept her. He kept her. And what about this baby that's not his? He raised that child as if it was his own. So I don't want to praise stepdads and stepmoms because I'm one. I don't want any praise, but bless and praise all of you who are step-parents who choose to treat a child like it's your own and love it like you were its actual mother or father. That's awesome. That's an amazing thing that you do. And I know it's hard sometimes, but that's what Joseph did. Now talk about faith. Faith, the Bible says, that faith without deed is dead. You can say you believe all you want, but if it doesn't cause you to do something, it's nothing. Not just believing, but acting on the belief no matter how it feels. Pregnant girlfriend that I've never slept with, conceived by the Holy Spirit? Sure, right? Yeah, I'll buy that one. Like, that's not an easy one to take. So if your girlfriend comes up to you and you haven't slept with her and she says, "Yeah, I'm pregnant. God got me pregnant." Now, who's going to believe that one? So would you think that maybe, just possibly, that Joseph had some doubts? I don't know. I just assume he probably did because he's a man. So I want you to accept this. And I want you to raise this child who's not yours. That's a tall order. And also, I want you to endure the public ridicule from those that would simply say that your girlfriend's a hussy and she's cheating on you. Like, do you think, I mean, we live in the world, do you think anyone said that about her? Right? Your girlfriend's a whore. I mean, we heard it when we were going to school, right? You think anyone talked about Mary that way? Probably so, in that little town where everyone knew each other, 200 people, 300 people. But over and above his own plans and his own doubts, and no doubt public ridicule and pressure, Joseph believed in and he trusted God's word that he had received through the angel. And he keeps the wife and he raises the child. That, my friends, is awesome faith. That's awesome faith. Mary believed everything God told her about what he was going to do. But Joseph, not only did he believe what God said he was going to do, but he obeyed when it was difficult to do so. And all of us need a little dose of that. Listen, he made some faith choices. And that's one of my favorite words in all the world. And listen, we all have the power, if you're a Christian, here's some truth into your life. If you're a Christian, the same power that raised Christ from the dead, 3 days in a cold grave, totally dead, not just like heart skipped a beat, dead and cold, dead flatline, raised Christ from the dead, and that spirit lives in you. And so you have the power inside of you to make quality faith choices. You can't say, well, this is hard. No, it's not. Nothing is hard compared to the Spirit of God that raised Christ from the dead. What could be tougher than that? Listen, if I go into a fight with someone, I love tough guys. I want the Spirit of God that raised Christ from the dead in my corner. That's what I would want. There's nothing tougher than that. So when you're trying to break an addiction, listen, if you're a Christian, then the power that raised Christ from the dead lives inside of you, and you don't need to say yes to the alcohol anymore. You don't need to say yes to the drugs anymore. You don't need to say yes to the lying and the cheating and the pornography, whatever that you don't have a hold of, but it has a hold of you. You have the power to say no to it because the power that raised Christ from the dead lives inside of you. So you can make a good choice. So you see this in Joseph, that in the face of adversity, he's got doubts and he's got fears and he's probably got everyone talking bad about his woman and he's freaking out like, my chick is pregnant and I never slept with her and she says it's God. Like, I should run. How many people run from marriage when it's hard? How many people would say that Joseph's situation in his marriage, like yours is worse? I mean, just imagine for a second, if right, you come home, you find out that she's been cheating on you. She's pregnant. You haven't slept with her. And she's pregnant. She says, yeah, God got me pregnant. Right? Would you believe this? So this is the deal. This is what Joseph has to do. So in the face of adversity, he knows what the truth of what God has spoken to him, and he makes a choice above and beyond what he's seeing and says, I'm going to trust you, Lord. And he obeys. Absolutely amazing. The power to choose. Being a Christian isn't just believing in God. Did you ever do that? You ask someone if they're a Christian, what do they say? Well, I believe in God. Whoop-de-doo-da. The Bible says in the book of James that even the demons believe and they tremble before him. Like, so not only do they believe in him, but they're afraid of him. Like, he's super real to them. Like, they tremble in his presence. We could probably use a dose of that. Amen. Tremble in his presence, right? The Bible says in Isaiah, I think it's chapter 6, oh, that you would come down, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains might quake in your presence. The mountains would quake in your presence. We need a little fear of the Lord up in this joint. You're in his presence right now. And people in the presence of God, if mountains would quake in his presence, don't put your feet up on the table. You know what I mean? We need a little bit of that in the church, don't we? The Bible says that the demons believe, but they tremble before him, but the problem is that they do nothing good in response to this belief. And that's a lot of us too. Listen here. Real belief and real faith will always, always equal action. All the time. If there's no action, if there's no stepping, if there's no doing, there's no belief. If there's no action, there's no faith. You can say all you want, but real faith produces action. True worship, worship in spirit and in truth, means doing that which God wants, living out what you believe all the time, no matter how it feels, no matter what it looks like. One of the most rare things in this world that needs to be seen are Christians doing as they say and as they believe. The chasm between what we believe and what we preach and what we do is monstrous, and it needs to be shrunk. Amen? It needs to be shrunk. It needs to be shrunk. We need to tighten up, don't we? We got to tighten up, brother. Joseph was awesome. God taught, he believed, and he obeyed. Boom, done. That's it. That's what he did. And we need more of that. Keeps his girl. He raises this kid that's not his own. God said so, and that's all that matters. And we need this kind of gritty faith in the church today. That we just do whatever God says to do and trust him with the results. And when we do what he says we're to do, no matter what happens as a result, you need to know, according to his word, that he brought that and he orchestrated that situation in your life. So the result that you think, pardon me, sucks, it doesn't. It's exactly what God wants to bring him glory. And we need to accept that. We don't necessarily need more information in theology, everyone. You know what we need? We need obedience to what you already know. We need obedience to what you already know. How many people in this room, you don't need to show your hands, I guess, because that could be prideful. I don't want to do that. How many people in this room have read through the Bible one time? Think about that. Now you know who you are. How many people have read, you don't have to show a hand, how many people have read all four Gospels? You know who you are. If you have, you know a lot. How many people have gone to church 100 times in their life? You know who you are. You know a lot. You've been taught. Some man opened up the scriptures and read to you and told you what it said. You know a lot. You don't necessarily need more theology. You need obedience to what you already know. So I want to give you some truth to take with you. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, I'm going to read this to you as we get close to winding down here for the evening. 1 Corinthians 8, 1 through 3 says, they're talking about food offered to idols and whether we should eat it or not, but that doesn't even really matter what the subject is, but it says, yes, we know that we all have knowledge about these issues, but while knowledge makes us feel important, some translations say knowledge puffs up, makes you feel, look at me, I know this. So we know a lot of stuff, right? So a bunch of stuff in our head, we know that makes us feel important, but it is love that strengthens the church. It's not what you know, it's what you do with what you know, right? We need some obedience up in here. We need some open it, read it, do it up in here. That's what we need in this church. That's what we need in the church across the world. We need to open it, read it, and do it. It says it's love that strengthens the church. That's why we're studying the Gospel of Luke, so that we can be a part of what Jesus Christ is doing to build his church, right? So how do we partner with Jesus to strengthen his church and build his church? It says love does that. Well, let me tell you, you don't need to know a lot more about theology. You need to learn a whole lot more. We need some obedience. John 14:15 says, this is what love looks like. If you love me, Jesus said, you keep my commandments. You know what that means? Obedience. Obedience. 1 John 5:3 says, loving God means keeping his commandments. You know what that means? Obedience. That's what God's looking for. Obedience to his word. Obedience to his word. Jesus said, listen, do as I did and do as I taught. Don't just memorize it. You go to Sunday school and you get the Bible verse memory thing. That's cool. Your word's written on my heart so I wouldn't sin against you. So we should memorize. But that's not what Jesus said to go do, right? He didn't say just go memorize my word. He said go live it. He said go live it. We need obedience in the church. And the only way we're going to get obedience in the church is if we can somehow, with the help of God's Holy Spirit, to change the way we think. So that when we read something, we can come to it with confidence and go, Lord, I'm going to do this thing, no matter what it looks like, no matter how it feels. This I've did it before and it didn't work out the way I wanted to, but I'm bold because you said I should do it and you're in charge of everything and it was brought into my life because you're there and it's up to you and it's your power and it's for your glory. And so I don't like it, but if you like it, I like it now. See, husbands know that. Right? Right? Honey, do you want to go ballroom dancing? Absolutely. If you like it, absolutely. Amen. Some newlyweds in the house. That was free. If she likes it, just go, I like it. You want to try it? Who thinks that they should try that? Right here, right now. Totally embarrass them. They're going back to Indiana. Who cares, right? Look at your husband and say, I like it. And what do you say? I love it. Amen. See, God's word does not return void. It always accomplishes what it sets out to do. So, Let's wrap this thing up. The band's going to come up and we're going to sing to Jesus. You guys want to sing to Jesus? You're going to sing that he's a mighty warrior. Listen, you know why he's a mighty warrior? You might not think of that right now, but because he's fighting for you right now. He's fighting for you right now. There's a war around you right now that you can't see. You only know it because it talks about it here. In the spirit, there's a war right now for your soul, for your peace, for your joy, for your happiness, for your church, for your family, for your kids, for your health, everything. There's a war right now. And he is fighting for you. And part of that fight was to send an unworthy messenger up here to tell you what God's word has to say about everything that's going on in your life. Every single thing. Everything. Jesus Christ is the word that became flesh. And his word just taught us about Joseph, the man who believed and acted in faith on his belief. And I mentioned it before, and I want to mention it again in closing. Would you want to be that kind of person? That's what God's calling you to tonight. Would you be that person who learns something from God? He speaks to you, whether it's through your word, whether it's through a preacher, whether it's through a prayer, whatever it is. If God speaks to you, will you be that kind of person? And of course, would we as a church, would be that kind of church that when God speaks and says, I want you to do this, would you be that church that has that gritty faith to just go, I'm in. I obey. That's what he's calling us to. That's the war he's fighting. That's the war he's fighting. And the soldiers, if you're a soldier in his army, that's your weapon. Your weapon is right here. And if you live out what this thing says, you'll see massive conquering. You'll see lives change. You'll see his kingdom advance in this community and beyond. But it takes obedience to his word. And that's what he's calling you to tonight. Amen? Amen. Pray with me. Is that cool? Let's talk to God. Let's thank him. Father, thank you for your amazing word. Thank you, Lord, that you're in charge of our circumstances and we don't have to really worry about them anymore because we understand your word tells us that it's you that's orchestrating them. That all things were sent from you by your power and intended for your glory. So even that thing that we have, whatever our thing is, it was sent by you. So much like Mary and Joseph, where they were promised amazing things, their expectations were probably high. It didn't really work out the way they had thought it would. Certainly, her expectation is not, well, this is going to be great. My son is going to be falsely accused and stripped down naked in front of everyone and murdered. That's not what being favored and my son being blessed of God. That can't be it. Lord, we are so blessed because we are on the other side of the story. And we can look back and see the amazing glory that you received, Father, through the life, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And for that we rejoice. So help us to be reminded always, Lord, that even though things might not be the way we expect them to be, that doesn't mean they're not exactly what you want them to be. It's for your glory. In Jesus' good name, amen. Thank you.